Artemis 1, en route to the moon again, but this time to stay there. The journey to the moon is surely the most extreme ever undertaken by a human being. It is incredible to think how the Apollo astronauts managed to reach our satellite aboard a spacecraft whose onboard computer had the computing power of a pocket calculator. Despite the technological limitations of the time, they were able to demonstrate the feasibility of a journey until then considered impossible. Today, more than 50 years later, with Artemis 1, we are preparing again to make this incredible crossing. We will use the same trajectories born in that golden age of space exploration, but we will have the support of much more advanced knowledge in the field of aerodynamics that will allow us to exploit in a much more efficient way the gravitational laws of orbital mechanics. And in the near future, such a journey may become less and less exceptional and more normal, but never entirely easy and without danger. Unlike atmospheric flight, spaceflight is in fact characterized by extremely limited freedom of movement. If an airplane can reach the same destination by making hundreds of different routes, the routes to the moon are much less. The reason is that the motion of bodies in space is bound to very precise laws dictated by gravitation. Exploiting these laws, the engineers of the Apollo program studied in the 60s, for the first time, the transfer trajectories to the moon that are still used today. But the Artemis mission will travel new ones. Believe me, it will be a return to the Apollo spirit. It will be something formidable, not to be missed. So, what would you say in order not to be caught unprepared by the events and to follow at best a 3-week space adventure, to do together a nice review of all phases of the mission? Would you like to? The exact day we do not know yet, but now we are sure to be in the home stretch. Whether it will be next December or January, soon we'll finally start the mission that will open the doors of human exploration of the solar system. From Launch Complex 39B at Kennedy Space Center, Artemis 1 will soon be launched, which, in addition to being the first mission of the Artemis program, will also be the first flight for both the Heavy Space Launch System and the Orion capsule. Because testing still needs to be done, on board Artemis 1 there will be no astronauts. As a result, life support, displays, and control instrumentation have been removed from the capsule. In its place have been inserted sensors and scientific instruments capable of detecting every single parameter inside the capsule, such as radiation levels, pressures, and temperatures. On board, however, there will be dummies on which sensors are placed to monitor all the levels of radiation they will undergo. The name chosen for the main dummy, Commander Munikin Campos, pays homage to the famous engineer of the Apollo 13 mission, the one who played a key role in bringing back safely to Earth the astronauts Jim Lovell, Jack Swigert, and Fred Hayes after an explosion in the service module not only thwarted the moon landing but also put a strain on the simple re-entry. Munikin Campos will wear the same spacesuit that was used by the astronauts and will be equipped with a series of sensors that can measure several useful parameters, such as the values of acceleration during the various phases of the trip, the vibrations to which the crew members will be subjected, and the level of radiation. Campos will not be alone. To keep him company, there will be Zolgar and Helga, two human torsos similar to those normally used for simulations of ballistic trauma. The service module, which will provide propulsion, electrical power, temperature control and life support to the crew module, will be developed by the European Space Agency. The Space Launch System rocket is designed for missions carrying crew or cargo to the moon and beyond, and will produce 4 million kilograms of thrust during liftoff and ascent to carry a vehicle weighing 2,700 tons into orbit. Lifted by a pair of boosters and 4 engines, the rocket will reach its period of maximum thrust within 90 seconds. After throwing the boosters, service module panels, and launch abort system overboard, the main stage engines will shut down and the main stage will separate from the spacecraft, consisting of the Orion capsule, the European Space Agency-provided service module, and the rocket's second stage, the interim cryogenic propulsion stage. The ESA module is placed under the actual capsule and will accompany it throughout the journey to and from the moon. Only before Orion returns to Earth, this module will be undocked. Inside are the capsule's main engines, gas and propellant tanks, and various secondary engines. The Space Launch System will bring the Orion capsule together with the second stage into a parking orbit at an altitude of about 200 kilometers. After a couple of revolutions around the Earth, at the appropriate time, we'll be deployed the solar panels and then turn on the engines of the second stage, which will produce an increase in speed that will allow the spacecraft to leave the parking orbit. This maneuver is called transfer lunar injection, and it will bring the spacecraft on the right course towards the moon. The transfer lunar injection is one of the most critical phases of the mission. The timing and the ignition of the engines is in fact essential to intercept the moon along its orbit around the Earth. In this way, the spacecraft can enter the lunar gravitational sphere of influence, a region of space in which the attraction of our satellite is dominant compared to that of the Earth. A delay or an advance of a few minutes in the transfer lunar injection maneuver can lead to a trajectory error such that the spacecraft will not enter the lunar gravitational sphere, but will be lost, drifting beyond the orbit of our satellite. The exact moment in which to start the engines to perform the transfer lunar injection is for this reason calculated with great care by the engineers in the years before the mission, taking into account the lunar motions. After this real topical moment, the third stage will be abandoned and the phase of the trip called transfer lunar orbit will start, which within 3 days will bring the capsule in sight of our satellite. At that point, the engines will be turned on again to slow down the spacecraft and to put it into circumlunar orbit. This maneuver is called lunar orbit insertion. There may be slightly different trajectories depending on the mission, but in any case, the approach used is the one just described for a simple reason: the safety of the crew. In case a malfunction of the propulsion system prevents the spacecraft to enter into lunar orbit, with this type of trajectory, the spacecraft will be able to return to Earth spontaneously without the need of any propulsive action, but simply using the lunar gravity with a gravity assist maneuver. In this case, we speak of the free return trajectory. The Apollo missions from 8 to 11 all flew on this type of trajectory, while the subsequent ones used hybrid trajectories. The reason for this change was that the free return trajectories, while safer, only allowed descent to the moon at the equatorial region. Since the landing sites of the missions following 11 were located at higher latitudes, it was necessary to adopt this type of solution. In a hybrid trajectory, the spacecraft initially flies a common free return, but during the crossing, it is abandoned to enter an optimal trajectory depending on the desired landing site. As soon as the free return is abandoned, the spacecraft loses the great advantage of being able to count on a spontaneous return to Earth. The idea behind this strategy, which was used in the Apollo program, was to remain on a free return orbit until all systems were verified and it was ensured that there was no malfunction. If any anomaly had occurred during these checks, the spacecraft would still have been able to return spontaneously by performing a flyby with the moon. After checking the status of all systems, the free return was abandoned and the spacecraft would enter on a different trajectory that would allow it to reach the predetermined landing sites. In case some problem occurred in this second phase, it would still be possible to put the spacecraft back on a free return using the propulsion system of the LEM, the lunar module, as a backup to the propulsion system of the service module. An example of the effectiveness of this strategy is the Apollo 13 accident. In that case, the loss of the command module occurred when the spacecraft had already left the free return trajectory, so the crew used the lunar module to return to it. Actually, on that occasion, the LEM engines were turned on also during the spontaneous return to shorten the return of 10 hours and to move the landing point from the Indian Ocean to the Pacific, where most of the American help was concentrated. In short, after more than 50 years, things have not changed at all. The first Artemis mission will see the Orion capsule reach the moon using the same trajectories of that time, with one difference. After having circumnavigated our satellite, releasing at the same time the 13 CubeSat satellites, which represent the secondary scientific payload, Orion will enter on a particular orbit called distinct retrograde orbit. This orbit, never used before, is extremely stable with respect to orbital perturbations because it interacts with the Lagrangian points L1 and L2 of the Earth-Moon system. And it will be the orbit that in the next missions will follow the Lunar Gateway, the Lunar Space Station, which will be built starting from 2023. This station will support all Artemis missions starting from Artemis 4 and will provide support for all future missions to the Moon and then to Mars. The presence of the lunar station will allow to completely change the approach to landings compared to the Apollo era. In the past, in fact, the spacecraft used by the Apollo astronauts were able to carry a much greater amount of propellant than the Orion. This resulted in a greater thrust provided by the engines that allowed, with the lunar orbit insertion maneuver, to reach a very low lunar orbit, from which to start directly the descent maneuvers. The philosophy of the Artemis program will be instead to dock the Orion with the Gateway on a much higher orbit, and from there descend to the surface with a dedicated vehicle provided by SpaceX. The orbital variant will take Orion 60,000 kilometers away from the Moon, thus beating the distance record achieved by Apollo 13 in 1970. After 6 days, the Orion capsule will exit the distant retrograde orbit with another lunar flyby, finally pushing it back on course for home. After the usual 3-day journey near the Earth, the spacecraft will shed its service module and dive into our planet's atmosphere, traveling at 11 kilometers per second. The heat shield of the capsule, so far never tested, will have to withstand temperatures of about 2700 degrees Celsius. After more than 3 weeks and a total distance covered over 2 million kilometers, the mission will end with a landing off the coast of Baja California. Will everything go well? Of course it will. And from the moment Commander Munich and Campos emerges safely from the capsule, we will begin to count the months until the launch of Artemis II, the mission that will take men to circumnavigate the Moon for the first time since 1972. A mission that reminds us very closely of the fantastic feat of Apollo 8 at Christmas of 1968. So yes, we are convinced everything will be fine.